My name is Shenzhan Liao. I'm the head of the School of Chinese Studies at China Institute. Since 1933, the school at China Institute has been teaching language, literature, philosophy, and now music in the heart of New York. So here I'm very honored to welcome everyone to tonight's program. Together with our partner, Bard College Conservatory of Music, we launched Music at China Institute to teach Chinese instrument. Currently, we have Guqin and Pipa classes. And we do programs, public educational programs like tonight, Music Chat, to bring the understanding of Chinese music, its history, culture, and people to the audience here. Thank you for being here. Thanks, I'm looking at the audience, many familiar faces. Thanks to Ingrid Ehrenberg, our trustee, and also chair of our education committee to be here with us, as well as our students, members, and friends coming together tonight. We appreciate your support. China Institute is a non-profit organization. We do appreciate your support to the program, to the organization. We have our membership forms out there, and we appreciate everyone's support. Before we start the program, I do want to say a few words about the coronavirus. Many of us at China Institute, like many of you in the audience, have friends, family members, people that we enjoy working with in China. So, sorry, you could get a little bit emotional. So at this unusually challenging time, we do want to send our hearts and prayers to all of them in China, and particularly, wish all the best for the time. So perhaps this is also a reminder for everyone here that it's valuable to celebrate a moment like this to enjoy music. In the end, music is universal and unites us all. So with that, I want to have the honor to introduce tonight's speaker, Professor Dai Xiaolian. Professor Guqin from Shanghai Conservatory of Music. And without saying too much, let's start with her music.
Thank you.
invite Dr. Mingmei Yip to join me to the stage. We will have a dialogue about Guqin and with more performances coming up. Dr. Mingmei Yip, she's a special translator today. First of all, she introduced Professor Dai to us. Without her, well, we would not have Professor Dai here today. That's a special thanks. And also, Dr. Yip also teaches Guqin here at China Institute with many students in the audience today and also a visiting professor at Bard College. So I have the privilege, China Institute has the privilege to have both Professor Dai and Dr. Yip here today. I probably can, well, if Professor Dai can understand me, I will ask my questions in English only, and Dr. Yip can focus in on translating Professor Dai's response. And then we will have a Q&A session after this, and then with more performances coming up. So, thank you, Professor Dai, for the wonderful performance. Many of the audience here are familiar with Guqin, so there will be some, like me, not so familiar and perhaps completely new to Guqin. So could you start with introducing the instrument and Guqin to the audience here?
Actually, we have known each other for almost 40 years, I guess. Yeah, and we were both quite young then, so, right? Yeah.
But she's my teacher. She's my teacher.
I'm older than Professor Da, that's why. And when I was teaching at Chinese University, and then we already acquainted with each other.
Okay. 那么介绍一下琴，那么其实我觉得大多数学古琴的人都应该也是对琴也是了解的，那么这个古琴可以说对古琴了解，其实我想问一下，就是在座的其实琴的到底是产生在什么历史年代，可能没有一个人说得清楚。
And I'm sure most of you, especially those who've learned how to study the Qin, knows about the history. But actually, exactly when it was invented, started to play, I'm sure most of you don't have much idea. So you started with the excavated, like Qin, the earliest Qin excavated. We start from that. An excavated in 1978 from the Zhenghou, you know, the grave, we had the so-called the first kind of known Qin, but they also evolved through history. So Han Dynasty or Tang Dynasty, we have different Qins, I mean different kinds of Qin.
但是最初的琴的产生的这个故事呢，我认为我是比较相信那么一个故事。比如说，他就是想是从这个中国有一个就是弓子，就是射猎的一个弓，其实很长的一个弓，是通过这个弓子拉弓的这么一个声音产生的。哇，我们的前辈，我们的古人。
And some scholars, including Professor Dai, she thought that the Qin was invented the connection of our daily life. in ancient China, people start to hunt with a bow and arrow and make a sound, and that should be, you know, the very first idea in adventure.
那么琴的历史也非常长，所以呢，就是说，自从乐器产生了以后呢，就是我们的前人、我们的前辈呢，就把这个音乐乐器呢，就是作为了中国汉文化的一个养生修身的这么一个音乐。
Started for a long time, the tune was invented actually for the purpose of self-cultivation and also for longevity, so it's kind of like Taoist influence, and that's the history of the tune.
所以我们在琴的这个乐器的这个本身来说呢，在琴的乐器上有很多的拟人化的和中国哲学思想说，像配合像。这个融合的这么的一个音乐，比如说有天圆地方，那么就讲我们的琴的面板是圆的，地板是方的。
The qin is deeply connected with Chinese philosophy. Thus, for example, the surface of the qin is round, so it represents or symbolizes heaven. And then the back of the qin is flat, so it symbolizes earth. So it's deeply connected with Chinese philosophies and culture.
然后也是有这么一个记载啊，就是讲到十三个徽位，就是其实是讲中国的，就是讲到十三徽和那个任乐十三徽，七弦就是讲这个有七，有这个有七天啊。然后说琴的这个形状呢，和人的这个是天人合一嘛啊，琴和人相合一。比如说这地方是眉骨啊，这地方是这个肩颈啊，这地方又是腰啊，等等啊。
So the organology of the qin is also connected, deeply connected to Chinese philosophy. For example, the three powers, 三才 heaven, earth, and humanity. Because now it's politically incorrect to say man. You have heaven and earth, but humanity, earth, and heaven.And the shape of the qin is also connected with the human bodies. You know, we have the neck, we have the waist, and also the 13 hui's. You know, the reference points of the qin is also represents, you know, the 12 months plus the lunar month.
那么这个琴产生之后呢，就是孔子的这个乐教的这个思想呢，就认为啊，是无功不成琴瑟，他把琴呢。就是作为一个文人修身养性的这么一个乐器，那么一直流传，一直这么一个概念，其实一直在现在还是始终有。
For example, Confucianism, there's a saying that if you are a scholar, gentleman, 尊敬 you never do without the qin or the se. Se is, you know, accompanying the qin in ancient China. So it's a long history of self-cultivation for the qin is for.Like longevity or cultivate to be a virtuous person.
As for we are the topic of the cultural and philosophical meanings of qin, and you mentioned Confucius, and it's really a long history. So perhaps in the long history of the qin evolving in China, would you share a few well-known stories that's related to the people?Especially the 君子 the gentleman, and the 琴，就是跟这个琴相关的这个故事和人，对，有没有在中国历史上大家这个比较熟悉的？
哦，那里有很多了啊。那么就是比如说就是我们琴曲当中有一首曲子是杏弹，琴曲当中有一首杏弹。那么大家也是知道这个孔子呢，他就是这就是乐教的思想，在从古至今呢，他就是从他的这个儒家的这么一个方式，那么他就是一个叫应该说是就是叫有教无类。有教无类啊，有教无类的思想。那么，他这么的一个，就是传承他的这个，儒家这个教学的这个方式呢，他就在一个 在一个地方去教学，那么后人就把他教学的那个地方呢，就称为就是信塔。那么我们琴曲当中呢，以他的这个故事呢，就有这么一个琴曲叫信塔社交。
Not too much, because I don't remember. Professor Dai said that the famous stories about, you know, related to Qin and Qin music, and of course we have a lot of Confucianism in Qin music, and Confucius values a lot music education, 乐教, and also the place that he taught, you know, his students is called the Apricot Order, 信坛. So, and also his famous philosophy is non-discrimination. You just teach anyone who wants to learn. You don't pick the students, you choose the smart ones or whatever.
所以呢，在琴曲当中，几乎呢，我们讲中国的琴曲呢，它几乎都是一个叫什么，叫标题性的它是一个有内容的，有的不是像西方音乐，比如说是什么 B 大调啊、G 大调的步骤一曲什么什么，它都是我们，比如说幽兰我们讲的这个幽兰，就是叫幽兰这首琴曲，那么它也是讲的内容，也是讲的是孔子的，他对于这个空谷深谷的是讲孔子的故事，就是他去在乐教的这个路上看见这个深山里面的这一颗。开放的这颗兰花，他觉得这个教育呢是不分高低的，他觉得就是这么一个故事。所以在琴曲当中，有很多的琴曲都是有这么的故事和这么的一个哲学的思想在里面。
Many many Qin compositions are actually programmatic in nature. That means they have a program. They always tell stories, you know, describe scenery or some sentiments.Always have a program, a subject matter. It's different from Western music. Maybe you have, like, in Western music, we have absolute music. It's just, you know, it's just a structure of sound. They don't tell a story. But in Qin music, it's always tell stories. For example, a famous music by Confucius is called the Solitary Orchid, Yao Lan. Yao Lan is Confucius actually lament himself because when he traveled, you know, to different places to teach music, and he feel that he didn't have much, how to put it,people understand his music education theory or philosophy.
他不是在教音乐，是在教那个儒家
的。对对对 ，and he of course is spreading his Confucian philosophy, not just teaching music. Of course, Confucius also can play the qin.
We talk about its connection with Confucius and Confucianism. What about other philosophical meanings behind Qin? Is it related to, for example, Taoism and other isms in China? Or it's more focused on the Confucianism as it has been for thousands of years, especially Han Dynasty, the dominant philosophical thoughts in China?
Yeah, 历史比较悠久，所以我们说在古琴的音乐文化当中呢，是三教合一，就是我们有儒家的思想，有佛教的，也有还有就是道教的思想。那么道教的琴曲呢，比如说我们是讲的那个叫欧陆忘机这么一个思想这也是有个故事在，要讲故事。
Perhaps we ask Dr. Yu to translate it first.
Director Liu asked, you know, besides the influence of Confucianism, do we have other influence of Ism? And of course, we have the Taoism, according to Professor Dai. And there is a very famous Qin piece, it's called The Skimless Seagulls. Oh, Lu Wang Ji has no skin.It's very the beginner's heart. You have to tell the story now.
其实从这个也是我所要思考的一个问题。故事是故事，那么我们如何从音乐用音乐来表现这个故事内容？这也是一个作为一个音乐家，作为古琴家所要思考的一个问题。
And Professor Dai's opinion is, I mean, yeah, we have the story, we have a lot of stories in Qin music, but music is music. Qin is music first, and then story secondary. So we have to put a lot of thinking into how to, you know, express the meaning, but through the skill and the music.
那么那比如说啊，那个梅花三弄，它也是表现了一种君子的这么一个这个一个意思啊，君啊，那么就是怎么去用音乐，用古琴的梅花三弄来表现这么一个高雅的这个梅花的高洁的这么的一个状态。
For example, the famous piece Three Variations of the Plum Blossoms is supposed to express the loftiness and elegance, you know, the virtuous scholar gentleman. But this is just a philosophy, you know, the thinking. So how do we really use music to express that? We have to, you know, do a lot of research and thinking.
I want to jump in and also ask, because well, it's a lot of deep thinking and philosophy and history behind the Qin. I'm curious, Professor Dai, when you started learning Qin, what drew you there? What was appealing to you? When did you start?
When I was 9 years
old.
Very young.
Yeah. So there is a study of Qin, the music of Qin and the artistic part of it as it's music, it's musical. It's it really attracts people. As well when you were 9 years old, and also there's deep knowledge and understanding behind it. So perhaps, well, could you share when you started learning Qin, what you found most interesting, and share a little bit of your own journey?
Okay. 当时学琴的时候也是可以说是文革后期。
Professor Dai started to learn the tune when she was only 9 years old. So we wonder, as a 9 year old, how can you understand the philosophy behind it? But that was after, right after the Cultural Revolution.
Yeah. 也是不说，到外面去问了，说你在学古琴啊。
Professor Dai learned the Qin from her, grandfather from your mother's side, right?
Yes.
Actually, she's a very most famous Qin masters, one of the most famous Qin masters in the whole world, Zhang Jijian 老师. And I want to jump in a little. I had the honor to have met Master Zhang, you know, in the 80s when I went to China.And so during the post-cultural revolution, as a 9-year-old kid, of course, you have no idea. And I am a carrier of this, you know, very precious traditional music. You just learn it. And then the grandfather talked to her, just don't tell other people you learn the tune when you're outside home. You understand why, right? Because it's just after the cultural revolution.
So in that time, 就是对于这个古琴的这个学习呢，只是一个生活。只是一个作为一个你需要一个音乐的这一个宣扬啊，对那小孩子来说啊，那么我当时就是学琴也好像也是没有任何的这种有个目标或者是什么，然后那个时候就像刚才说的，也是不可能是什么走到什么专业的这么一个领域里面去，只是一个家里的这个业余爱好去学习，所以。我也是现在回忆起来想想，那个时候学琴非常放松，没有非常放松。
Okay, so when I just use the first person, when I was a child, a 9 year old, of course, I had no goal that I would be a professional, you know, musician in the future, and so it's very relaxed kind of playing because it's just fun for her. It's part of the daily life anyway, because you know she was taught by her grandfather.
所以我现在看到有很多的小孩子学琴，为了考级，为了考学校，我觉得他们也非常累，就是，但是总的来说，我觉得学琴呢，你就是应该说是不是需要有一种很强的一种目标性，特别是学古琴，你要学它的文化，你要学它的这个历史，然后你真正的去品味古琴里面带给你的这样一个美，我觉得这个是，所以。
To learn Qin, you have to really taste the flavor, the beauty of the musical instrument. So don't put too much pressure on yourself. I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to pass an examination, I have to, you know, enter conservatory. There's too much pressure for, you know, young children nowadays learning the Qin. But well, during Professor Dai's era, it's very relaxed. You learn the culture, the history, the aesthetics.
Well, it feels like it's a very different time learning Guqin now. So could you perhaps also talk about what's the current situation learning Qin in China?
As some of you may already know, in 2003, the Qin was acknowledged by the UN, United Nations, as one of the intangible cultural inheritance. And after that, and before that, the Qin actually was kind of unknown to most people. Very few Qin makers, very few teachers, very few students. But right after it was acknowledged by the UN, and then suddenly the Qin became much more popular.
Mm-hmm. 那么后来就渐渐越来越多人，那么对社会上的学琴的人也是越来越多。我觉得是对古琴的认识，这也是一个好处，但有的时候也会带来一些其他方面的一些问题。So
after that, 2003, many more people started to learn the Qin, and the Qin was a lot more well known than in the past, and there it create. You know, a lot of benefits to the Qin, of course. I mean, more people know about it, of course it's better, but it also create some unnecessary like disadvantages.
Mm-hmm. 然后还有就是很多的研究的成果也没有那么快的就是成为显现。
Because the changes were so sudden, so actually in some perspective it's not a good thing. Because actually you don't have enough teachers, I mean qualified teachers, and you don't have enough books or documentation, you know, written articles about this instrument. So this is the disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And what you mentioned, well, we mentioned that your great uncle, Master Zhang Ziqian, was and still is well considered one of the best master of Qin, and he is the Guangming Pai, the school of Guangming, the master of that in China. So I'm just curious, as you mentioned, there are a lot of people learning Qin now since 2003. And well, the field seems has a variety of different people playing in the field. What's your thought on the different schools of Qin in China, or do you consider that as well? There are still many schools of Qin in China.
这个关于古琴的流派呢，这是一个非常复杂的问题，也是一个非常会引起一些矛盾的问题。This is a very complicated and controversial question about the Qin styles or Qin schools in China.
那么古琴的流派呢，其实我们就是讲它是一个历史传承的啊。那么我们讲蜀派啊。 那么蜀派其实是在唐代的诗词当中，就是讲到有这个蜀声召集，或者在唐在我们的琴书当中，蜀声召集如流水啊，然后是讲到浙派也是从宋代开始，那么讲到广陵琴派呢是，也是从唐代的一首诗就是讲到是，秦奏临琴广陵歌。 从这个一个诗中才我们了解到有这么一个
And about the different schools of Qin music of different styles is a continuing legacy. It's very hard to make it clear. For example, in Tang Dynasty, it was recorded as a Su style, which is very boisterous, like a flowing water flowing from a cookie. Or in the Song Dynasty, we had the the style, but it's not, so it's a long historical process.
那么，我就是讲到，就是关于就是流派呢。那么现在，其实当时都是因为是一个地区，不像现在的交通这么方便，流通这么方便，所以就会在某个地区呢，会产生这个流派的这种风格流派。
And in the past, because we couldn't travel like we did today, right, with internet or easy travel, so actually a certain school created.Is because it's for the location, like Guangdong or Beijing is for the location, you develop a certain style.
Yeah, well, as you mentioned, well, like Guangdong itself also is coming from this Tang Dynasty poetry, and then perhaps well, it's more associated with certain regions in China instead of a particular style. Is that a correct understanding?
就刚才您提到的这个广陵派也是从唐代的一个诗歌里面这样流传出来的那这个就是说也是跟地域更多的联系而不是说跟特别的这个古琴的演奏风格的这样一种联系这样理解对吗
也对也不对但是太复杂了那么后来的这个文字记载当中呢广陵派它的流传的方式又是从虞山派来的
That is a sort of academic question because Guqin Master Dai also, you know, originated from the Yushan Pai, and it's, I think for Long Qin Zhen it's a little bit, you know, too much to.
所以关于这个流派呢，我是这样子认为，就是流派除了有风格、有地域风格，那现在地域风格已经很少了，是吧？如果我们现在要讲流派的话，还必须要有它的思想。这个就是他的这个指导思想在里面我打个比方就是比如说是虞山派严天池他那个时候建立的虞山派他就是非常反对他摒弃了情歌的这么的一个演奏形式所以在他传承的松弦管琴谱当中呢是没有这个情歌
The style, of course, is related to the regions, different regions, but of course, it's also connected to the playing and the performance styles. For example, it's a style called the Yushan style, the Yu Mountain or Mount Yu style. And then the founder was called Yan Tianqi, and he was very against Qin songs, that means against singing and playing at the same time.
就是说我们现在如果是要重拾就是重新再捡来这有一定的风格流派的话不仅仅是你弹什么曲子或者是你演奏什么那么一个是演奏技术演奏风格上面有一些区别那么还要呢就是说你对于琴的理论你对于琴的这个思想境界你有什么样的区别那么可能对于风格的区别
And if you claim you belong to a certain style, then you have to really understand the philosophy behind the style, the leading thoughts behind the style, not just you know, the technique, of course that's important to the playing style, but you have to understand what is the thoughts behind a certain style.
Well, Professor Dai, you have devoted over 40 years to the education of Qin and practice of Qin, and now you are a professor of Qin in Shanghai. So I'm also curious about, as we're talking about, the different style to be systematic, to be really into the professional Qin playing field, what are the curriculums your students would learn as under your guidance, to be a professional Qin musician?就是您的这个古琴专业，对对对，对这个古琴专业，您现在在上海音乐学院的古琴专业，那这些学生他们会学什么样的内容呢？因为您提到就是这个古琴的专业化和这种系统的学习，可不可以介绍一下？
可以可以啊， 就是作为大学的音乐专业的来说，因为我们是大学教育，大学教育它不是说一个点一个很细的一个对的一个某个流派来说，这就是大学，如果是比较单一的，那是说我们大学的一个失败。那么所以我觉得从我在学习过程当中呢，我是从老师那里继承的是广陵风格的流派。那么后来我也是跟龚斌老师也是学习过的，龚老师也教了我很多的其他风格流派，比如说梅阳派的曲目啊，其他风格的曲目啊，余山派的曲目。后来我也是跟那个吴景的学生学，所以这样来说呢，就是说对于风格流派呢，作为大学的教学呢是应该更广泛一些。所以我们在大学教育的过程当中，除了是一个单一的你的一个主要的一个风格流派，你会紧紧抓住，或者是你但是更多的去学自己的这个风格，更广泛的去学习。
As a university professor, we don't want to be kind of too simplified to teach it. We should be, you know, learn all different kinds of styles, but be focused on a certain one that we have pen up, you know, to learn a lot. If it's too simplified, and then it's a failure if you teach it in the university.
那么现在就是说，从专业的角度来说，因为我们还要再考虑到古琴的，就是从音乐的这个专业发展的这个角度去，如何它在这个就是专业的领域里面，它能够发挥古琴更大的一个它的可能性，它的作用。
We hope from a professional level, as professional musicians, you know, educated in conservatory.We hope that we can, you know, have more influence in society as professional musicians.
那么，比如说我们就是在继承传统的这些音乐的基础上面学习理论，比如说学习打谱等等啊。那么还要就是说，把这个古琴音乐发挥它更大的能量，就是它在音乐的环境下。比如说我们是做和古琴和 ensemble 啊，和古琴和那个小的这个交响乐团啊，然后做一些重奏的实验乐这样的一个实验的发展。
And as you know, professional musician, we hope to develop the Qin music's potential to its fullest. That's why we also work with orchestras, ensembles.
Etc. Not just like a solo instrument. Well, that's what we're really touching upon, not only continuing and preservation of Qin, but also the current innovation, well, how to move this music form forward, and especially related to the current contemporary different forms and formats. So perhaps you can also talk aboutthe innovation of Qin. You have been really focusing on that direction for this past few years.
我想很多人对于古琴的喜爱，有很多人对古琴的喜爱，它是出于从书上面来看，还是更多的是觉得哇，这古琴的声音有这么美妙。我想问大家，你们是从书看的，还是喜从琴的声音
wait for the translation, please.
Professor Dai says a lot of people, they really like the Qin, but mainly through books, because a lot of philosophy is studying about the Qin as actually is very metaphysical, right? They fall in love with the Qin. But do you really understand the music?
那么不是我想要说一句，如果你真的是从你是从音乐当中去，你是从书里面去了解这琴的话，你就不会来学这个琴，对吧？但是你如果是学这个琴，你肯定是认为这个声音非常美妙，我想要自己去一眼睁睁乐器。
If you just read through the books, might be not interested to really play the music. But if you really love the music, then you really seriously try to learn it.
Actually, well, there was a survey with the audience. Do you like to read about Qin, or do you like to play or listen to the music of Qin?
I like play.
I like to listen.
I want to know about the history.
The history, and you raise your hand first. What's your answer to this? So it sounds like there are really multiple entries for 14. And I'm more of a bookish. I love the intellectual stories and meanings of Qin.
I do believe that a lot of people are really attracted to the beautiful, tenor sound of this, you know, unique instrument.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, as a teacher and a musician, I really want to see the music of Qin
As a teacher, you know, educator and a musician, I really want to explore the potentials of Qin music to its fullest. And that's my goal. Not just perform. I wanted to, you know, have more influence.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a lie. Okay, Professor Dai says a lot of people, you know, like viewers, you know, the Qin is a very self-centered instrument. I only play for myself. It's this very snobbish energy, right? Very snobbish. I don't play for vulgar people. I only play for myself. Self-entertainment and self-cultivation. But to me personally, it's not what I'm saying. I think it's a lie. If you have a very good skill, you want to play for other people. That's why we have the phrase G in, you know, you play for those who understand your music. You need people to understand you. Sorry.
And I know that when you have a video to show that Qin is not just for yourself, shall we?
Okay, yes. 我再说一句，就是说，也就是我之前我刚刚前面说过的，就是说，把古琴的历史如何通过音乐来表现，这个是我一直是想要方式去研究的，因为琴有很每个琴曲它有故事。这个故事怎么通过你的演奏？他们说：“哎呀，你的这个梅花三弄啊、平三落雁啊，或者是等等，那么他的这个故事是通过演奏来表现。”那么，就因为有这样的一个思考，有这么一个，有这么一个要求，是想自己如何去把这个古琴更好的向对观众来展示。所以在2018年的时候呢，我策划。我和我的学生成立了一个乐团，古琴乐团，就是这个音乐会，就是把琴的文化和音乐相结合。那么这个已经演出了十多场了，我可以把这个。
Started from 2018, me and my students, because we want to, To make the Qin story, so many, you know, rich stories in Qin repertory and history, we want to express all of this through our music. So we set up like a small ensemble to fulfill our goal of, you know, conveying Qin's history, beauty, and all the stories through the music. So that's what we do.
它所接的五十是可以用药五十的，所以用这个数量。
用这个果实，用这个枝叶来形容他的一种成果，培养学生的这种精神和人格。天籁地籁人籁，那今天要弹奏的这种心籁，毫无疑问说的就是心声，心里头发出来的一种声音，通过琴把它表达出来。第三首呢，归去来此，这个词看起来可能是消极的，又何尝不是有一种积极的一种元素在里面呢？到底是消极还是积极呢？事实上是在一种意念之中的。第四篇章呢是玄寂琴思，这里边呢是玉簪琴素。我们听过琴歌，今天很特别，还能够听到琴戏。
Traditional team composition, but we add two part performance. And Professor Dai is the primary, the bottom line, and then her students is the secondary ones.
那么这个故事，我们也知道这个故事。那么在音乐的演奏和我们的整个的一个形式当中，就体现出来这么的一个故事的这个方式，就是通过这个音乐来表示这个故事的背景。
So we just want to, utilize the modernized version of this traditional piece to express, the whole story of Confucius' teaching and, African culture.
那么后面还有一曲目是关于就是这个昆曲艺术，那么这个曲子是昆曲的玉簪记啊，玉簪记呢里面从昆曲的这个它的这个剧目当中呢，它就是讲的是昆曲的这么一个它就是讲的这个男主角呢弹琴和这个女主角在谈情说爱，那么我们就把这个昆曲的故事用这个古琴和其他的那个四个乐器的这么一个四声部的这么一个组合来表现这么一个
Four part, as you might remember, the one with the J hairpin is originated from a Qin opera. Because in the Qin opera, there is the scene with the scholars, playing tune and to seduce the beautiful lady, and then they transpose, to a Qin version.
其实这也是体现了古琴和其他艺术门类的一个结合。
This is to explore the Qin's potentials to work with other instruments, not just only solo instruments.
Yes. And I know that what you have prepared, a piece that actually would be related to what we're talking about, the innovation of Qin. Shall we now? Yep. Traditional techniques were related to the fingerings and this particular piece. Could you use it as an example to perhaps elaborate what are the differences between the traditional techniques and this innovation in this piece?
So, 所谓的现代的技术呢，其实是把传统的一些指法的它组合在一块，而且是很迅速的组合，快速的组合，那么形成了一个因为在节奏当中其实是要跟这个旋律的节奏来， 所以呢就是快速的组合了以后，大家以为啊、哦、看上去这个是一个、比较新的一个指法。那我打个比方，比如说这个啊、
谢谢
这个是调，这是拼，然后这个是勾，是不是？那么在这个所有的这个指法当中，其实在这个传统的里面，这些指法都有，只是在新的作品当中把这些指法是快速的组合。
Actually, like the small example that Professor Dai illustrated, actually it's still the same traditional fingering, tail, bow, wall, something like this. But actually the combination, the composite fingerings is just much faster. So you think it's something very new, but actually it's still based on traditional, foundational, traditional. And you can, musical styles, of course, is very different from traditional styles, so you feel that it's something very new.
And I want to be respectful for the audience, and that what we would need to have a Q&A session before the ending performances. But I do have one more question in terms of the influence of Qin outside of China. Could you talk about the kind of effects and influences that outside of China regarding this? 就是琴在海外的，对中国之外的影响与发展。
哦，琴在中国之外的发展和影响呢，就是我因为也去过几个国家，去过几个，但每到一处呢，就看到大量的这古琴的爱好者。这个特别是去年，比如说我们在巴黎的演出，获得了成功啊，那么在。也是看到了很多的这个古琴的爱好者。那么除了古琴的爱好者之外呢，我觉得就是说，纯粹的对古琴没有一个，不是他没有就是说之前他没有学过，或者是他没有了解的这些朋友们呢，确实是对我们这古琴的这个产生的这个音乐和它的这个风格是有一种极大的一种吸引力。这个是我。
Yeah, because Professor Dai has traveled to many, many different countries, and she felt that actually those people who have little understanding of the Qin or never heard of the Qin, actually they feel that the Qin's tone is very attractive to them. I think it's because of the mystery. And actually, if you remember, we played in the same concert together about 15 years ago in a museum. Yeah, a long time ago. Yeah.
所以呢，因为我也听了有外国朋友吧，完全是没有听过的。他就是说，他一听这琴的音乐，他就觉得这个典型的中国的气质出来。
So when foreigners who have never heard this instrument, if the first time they heard it.And they feel that it's very standard kind of Chinese music artistic temperament. They just feel very Chinese. They like it.
那么现在就是说，对我们国内的人来说啊，或者是对古琴这个听过一些，他也非常反对，比如说这种新的作品。
And even people from China, and actually a lot of people against this kind of new style.They don't like it because I think they want to get rid of tradition.
所以我对在这种情况下，比如说我就是开音乐会，有个外国朋友，他就从来没有听过古琴的。那么我就问他，我说你，比如说我刚才弹的新的这个创作的作品，你有什么样的感受？然后他就跟我讲。你哪怕你弹新的作品，我听上去也还是像古琴。
So when she asked some, you know, foreigners who never heard the Qin and what is their impression of the Qin, or you know, they like it or not, the new composition, and then they think that even its new composition, it still sound like the Qin to them.
Well, in the video, you showed that Qin was together with other Chinese instruments. I'm also wondering if Qin can be played with the Western instruments.
当然。
So if the Qin can play with other Western instruments, actually I heard it personally 2 years ago when I was at Shanghai Music Conservatory, and one of Professor Dai's students, right? And he played, one played the piano and one played the Qin, and surprisingly, they go very well together. Even the Qin has no amplifier. To me,
Well, thank you. I want to open the floor to the audience. So the gentleman in the back and then the lady in the middle.
Thank you very much for your presentation and illustration with the Guqin. Two quick questions. I'm looking at the instrument and I'm wondering, is there a choice type of wood lumber that's ideal for this type of instrument? And the second question is, Chinese traditional music is in today's China and other areas where there are large Chinese groups. Traditional music, is that? I don't know how to say it. Is it a particular age group that tends to want to listen to this kind of music? I'm wondering whether, by comparison, if the youngsters today, let's say the 20-somethings, the 30-somethings in age, do they show any inclination to, besides the so-called modern music and what have you, to listen to that?
就是这个可能就是跟这个怎么说呢年龄和这个出生的年代相关，他讲的有一定的道理，就是不同的年纪的人呢对琴的理解不一样，就比如说我们小孩子的时候学琴，那小孩子对历史的知识不是很清楚，对文化的感受也不是很多。可能小孩子的他的对于古琴的学习的理解就不太一样，但是到了二十几岁的大学生，可能他的这个知识的含量还没有这么深厚，他的理解也比较怎么说，就是一个不同的年龄段吧，我想可能是不太一样啊。这个是我遇到的一个这么一个。
According to Professor Dai, more the different age group, they have a different understanding and perspective of the instrument. If you learn it as a child, of course you don't understand, the history, the culture, and you're in your 20s to understand more, but you still not understand it as, you know, someone middle age. Now what is your first question?
Colonial wood.
可能有很多的学琴的人，听琴的人认为传统的琴曲就是很慢的，一个声音慢，就是很慢的，是吧？啊，那么现代的音乐都是很快的，啊，我想这个可能是一种概念上的一种，谁听过呢？你怎么知道传统的音乐就是这么慢？
看书不一定是正确的。Surprise, yes. A lot of misunderstanding, like a Qin piece, a Qin composition, are always very, very slow. Usually play like this. But actually, of course, it's not true. There are a lot of different styles of Qin composition. It is actually our imagination of ancient Chinese culture. It doesn't mean it's like that. And of course, nowadays we don't have, you know, recordings from the past to understand, you know, the tempo.
那么我就是想，我们古代的也是人，对吧？我们在书上可能看到有一个，打个比方，就是说有一种叫"笑不露齿"， 不是像不入次，是吗？难道古人的那个嵇康这样的一个非常壮实的这个男人，他不会哈哈哈这样笑吗？
It's all a misunderstanding. For example, there is a famous saying, when you smile, you shouldn't reveal your teeth, because it's supposed to be bothered. But actually, Professor Dai's challenge, like some people like the great philosopher and musician Guqin, you know, in Wei Jin Dynasty, he's a very manly person, very vigorous. I mean, she couldn't imagine if he smiled like this without revealing his teeth. So it's only our misunderstanding.
So I think Qin 当时就是讲到了teeth。人和情，情就是表示了人的一种情感，是吧？表示了人的，表示我们人类的一种感受，一种文化。那么，在这样的一个环境下面，我觉得它是可以表现得非常丰富多彩。
Because Qin music actually is the person is behind the music that he tries to express his feelings. So.As all the different peoples in the world, of course, we have different feelings. It's not just, you know, limited to one.
我在听叶老师的，我再讲一句，就是古琴音乐在传统里面，它还是有一个情歌的表现形式。除了演奏器乐、琵琶，它还有是琴和唱的一个结合。所以我们接下来可以听到叶老师和这些声乐的情歌的
两个情歌。
啊，你已经翻
译了。OK, so I'm going to play a piece that is a very famous pop song. I'm sure most of you or all of you have heard of the song "沧海一声笑." 听过吗？都听过。And laughter is about to turn to a sea. And it's composed by a pop. It's a cultural icon in Hong Kong. 黄沾，听过吗？广东话叫黄沾， it's very very famous. It has been a few years ago.And he composed this for a martial arts movie, 叫江湖什么笑傲江湖啊 ，Laughter 什么江湖声 ，Two Hundred Ten. And he actually only has two melodies, the whole song. Okay, so based on these four melodies, I arrange a Qin song for it.Should I turn it on? I'm going to sing. Not going to sing. Okay. However, I don't know what happened. My mouth is very, very dry tonight.
Many things.
So, if I no notes come out from my mouth, that means I'm so dry, I can't keep singing. But I prepare with the singing.
Taste.
好干了，不晓得为什么。Because Qin people, you have to play your own tune. but I'm just too lazy to bring my own, so I'm using Professor Dai's tune. 哎，对不起啊，还是很干的。Because I'm not used to this instrument, so I tried it earlier, but let me try it. Okay.
相思如梦萍。
us so much. Well, that would conclude our program today, but we do have a few presents for Professor Dai. One is, well, from China Institute. Well, in 1999, we had an exhibition of Guqin here at our gallery. So this is a catalog from that exhibition. And we do have more catalogs out there available for you. It really dive into the history, culture, philosophy of Guqin. So I think, well, this is really a proper gift for you. Thank you, Professor Dai.
And then my turn. And my book. Actually published some time ago, but it's republished, edition version of Qin 音乐艺术 and sent to Professor Dai.
Small reception for everyone. Please do stay, and well, we hope to see you next time at our program. Thank you very much.